He raised his own son, Jesus Christ, the first fruits of the resurrection. He raised him up from the dead. What a glorious promise for us in Christ. This morning we are in Acts chapter 9, verse 36 down through verse 43. At this point, you've known me for multiple years, and many of you have attended funerals where I have been asked to preach the funeral sermon. And it becomes very apparent when you go to one of those funerals, really when you go to any funeral, that the funeral of a person who loved Jesus is very different than the funeral of a person who didn't love Jesus. I explained it at a previous funeral that the funerals of people who don't love Jesus have a sort of bottomless, black hole kind of mourning. It just doesn't stop. It's just there, and it's just this deep, dark weight, and it's absolutely awful. But the mourning that takes place at the funeral of a person who loved Jesus is not limitless. It is a limited mourning. It has a stopping point, because when you are celebrating the life of somebody who loved Jesus, you understand that the promise for those who look upon the Son of God, who look on Jesus and believe in His name, He promises them He will raise them up on the last day. Their funeral is temporary. It's a short-lived funeral. So we weep and we laugh in the same day, right? It's a short-lived funeral. I want you to understand this truth from this passage this morning, because I think this is the purpose that this text here is included. It is included for us to understand this truth. So if you will, write this down. Because Jesus raises the dead to life, we can have hope that is greater than death. Because Jesus raises the dead to life, we can have hope that is greater than death. If you remember last week, we looked at verses 32 through 35, and the Apostle Peter had gone to a town called Lydda. About 35 miles to the west of Jerusalem, northwest of Jerusalem. He goes there to Lydda. He comes across a man who has been paralyzed for the last 8 years. And he comes up to this man named Aeneas, and he says, "In the name of Jesus Christ, rise up. Jesus Christ heals you." This man rises up off of his poor man's paralytic mat, off of his bed. He gets up, he's restored in an instant. God does a recreative or a creative work in this man's life. And all of these people in the city of Lydda and in the plain there where Lydda sat, in the plain of Sharon, they all hear about this. They see this man, Aeneas, whom they knew. They see this man. They see what Jesus is able to do, and they believe in the Lord Jesus, and they call on him for salvation. So you see there in just those few verses, there are two healings that take place. Jesus proves that he is Lord over the body in the healing of Aeneas, the paralytic man, no more. And he also shows that he is Lord over the soul, as all these people in Lydda and Sharon believe in Jesus and their souls are healed. They are saved from their sin. They are saved from death, and they are given the promise, the guarantee of resurrection from the dead because of the power of Jesus. And in these verses, verse 36 down through verse 43 of Acts 9, you see the power of the resurrection of God, the resurrection power of Christ, work itself out through this miracle in this woman Tabitha's life. Look at verse 36 with me. It says, "Now there was in Joppa," Joppa was about 12 miles to the west of Lydda where Peter was. Joppa's right there on the coast of the Mediterranean Sea, right there up next to the water. It says, "Now there was in Joppa a disciple named Tabitha. Now, you might ask, where did this woman come from? How did she become a disciple of Jesus? You actually have a bit of a record of where she probably had heard the gospel from. You remember the man named Philip? We read about him in Acts chapter 8. He is the one who was sent out into the wilderness and on the road there from Jerusalem to Gaza. And on that road, he encountered a man named, we call him the Ethiopian eunuch. That's how he's described. His name is not given. But this Ethiopian eunuch, he hears the gospel and he is baptized. You remember that after Philip baptized this Ethiopian man and brings him up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord carries Philip away and he places him in a place called Azotus. And it says that Philip, it says that in Acts 8:40, that as Philip leaves Azotus, he goes up to Caesarea. Joppa was right there on the road on the way to Caesarea. And it says that Philip stopped in every town on the way and he preached to them the gospel. It is very likely that Tabitha was a convert of Philip's evangelistic ministry. So we come across this woman named Tabitha. Now, Tabitha is an Aramaic word. It is an Aramaic name, but we are given a translation here of what her name means. Now, there was in Joppa, verse 36, a disciple named Tabitha, which translated means Dorcas. Now, don't let it fool you, because when you hear that word Dorcas, I saw some of you adults, some of you get a little snicker on your face, and you remember when we used to use that word in the third grade, right? And we used it as more of an insult than a term of endearment. But the word Tabitha, translated into the Greek, is Dorcas, but that word means gazelle. It's not a derogatory name at all. This is actually a term of endearment. Can you think of an animal that exemplifies elegant, genteel beauty than a gazelle? That's what this woman's name was. Her name is Tabitha, gazelle. She exemplifies beauty in her name. But what you're going to notice here is more than her name being beautiful, she is clothed in the garments of a righteous life. Her life is more beautiful than her name. Look at how she's described here. Named Tabitha, which translated Dorcas, she was full of good works and acts of charity. That is what clothed her in beauty. It was the garments of a righteous life. She's full of good works and of charity. That word charity, every time it is used in the New Testament, it refers to giving alms to the poor. So you can see what this woman was about. She is about helping those who cannot help themselves. She is generous. She helps the poor. She gives to the needy. Later on, you're going to see that she has a special ministry, not only to the poor and the needy, but also to the widows, many of whom were impoverished. So this woman is full of good works, clothed in the garments of a righteous life. The truth is this, no matter what your name is, ugly or beautiful, you can have a life that is characterized by good and righteous deeds done in the name of Jesus. You can have an adornment in your life before God when you are clothed in the righteous deeds befitting of a saint. But look at verse 37. In those days she became ill and died. This is a downer, isn't it? We read about a woman with a beautiful name, an even more beautiful life. And yet what does it say in verse 37? She became ill and died. The truth is, and many of us, we don't want to hear this, but the truth is that the righteous and the wicked alike die. Death comes both for the righteous and the wicked. In fact, the writer of Ecclesiastes, he laments this point, that death comes for the righteous and the wicked, to the wise and the foolish. And he laments the fact, he says, death comes to the righteous and death comes to the wicked, and I've seen it in my life, that even the wicked, they will prolong their life through wickedness. And this vexes him. But death comes for us all. You live a righteous life, death will come to you. You live an unrighteous life, death will come to you. You live a wise life, a foolish life, death will come. We all die the same. But the outcome of that death is very different. You see that here from this text. In those days, verse 37, she became ill and died. And when they had washed her, they laid her in an upper room. Very interesting what verse 37 tells us and what verse 37 does not tell us. Verse 37 tells us that they washed her body. So the post-mortem process in Jewish burial customs had two phases, really. The first phase, you see it accomplished here. They take the body after the person has died, they clean the body, and they put the body in the upper room of the home, normally the guest room of the home. This was probably a more wealthy person's home. They put her body up there, upstairs, in the guest room, and you know what they're preparing for? They're preparing for her visitation. It's an open casket visitation, and people would come to the house within the day or the next day and a half, and they would come and they would pay their last respects to this person who died. But one thing that you don't see in this verse, if you do the study and you become familiar with Jewish burial processes, is that they completed the first step of the post-mortem process and they washed the body. But what they did not do is anoint the body. What they'd always do is they would take spices and ointments and things like that, and they would anoint the body. And it's a glorified way of showing respect and also just to take care of the stench that's going to take place. But you notice that that the anointing of the body is significantly absent from verse 37. I would ask the question, why? Why did they not anoint Tabitha's body for burial? I honestly think it was indicative of their faith. They were trusting in God. They were in expectation that God's servant Peter was in a nearby town and he's going to come here. Jesus raises the dead to life. That's what he promised us. His servant is right here in Lydda. Let's go get him as quickly as possible. We're not going to anoint the body. We are going to hope in the Lord for resurrection here. Look at verse 38 to see a bit of confirmation there. Verse 38 says, since Lydda was near Joppa, just 12 miles, about a three-hour walk, since Lydda was near Joppa, the disciples, here it is, hearing that Peter was there, sent two men to him, urging him, please come to us without delay. How did they hear that Peter was there in Lydda in the nearby town? They had heard, it doesn't take long for word to spread in a small town, amen? You know what I'm talking about. It doesn't take long for word to spread in a small town. And so Peter is there in Lydda. He has just healed this man in the name of Jesus, healed Aeneas. And everybody in Lydda and Sharon, they're experiencing a spiritual awakening. There are many people believing in the Lord Jesus. And so there are people, I take it to mean, there are people that have run to Joppa and said, you're not going to believe what Peter has done in the name of Jesus over here in Lydda, in the town next over. He has told Aeneas to get up off his mat and walk. And that crippled man, you'll know him. Y'all been over to our house when Aeneas has been there for dinner. Y'all know him. He couldn't walk. He couldn't move. He's the guy that we were feeding by hand. He's walking now. You're not going to believe this. And the apostle Peter is here in our town. And so these people in Joppa, they see Tabitha dead. And they say, this could not have come at a better time. The apostle Peter is in the nearby town. Don't even waste the time in anointing the body with spices because we're hoping we don't even have to bury her. So they send a few servants and they run. I take it they ran there to Lydda to go and to get Peter. And they ask him, please come to us without delay. Would you please get here before we have to put her in the ground? Would you get here before the decay and the erosion starts to take place in her body? Would you hurry, Peter? Look at verse 39. So Peter rose and went with them. And when he arrived, they took him to the upper room. All the widows stood beside him, weeping and showing tunics and other garments that Dorcas made while she was with them. A few things that you see there from verse 39. You get a bit of an insight into the context of what's taking place, and you get a bit of an insight as to what Tabitha's ministry was all about when she was alive. See that Peter is there, and there are widows all around, and they are weeping, they are mourning. There must be saints all around just as well, weeping and mourning. It tells you that Tabitha must have had quite a ministry to the widows, quite a ministry to those who had been impoverished at no fault to their own. She ministers to them, but you get an insight as to what ministry she had. What does it say that they are holding here? All the widows stood beside him, weeping and showing tunics and other garments that Dorcas made while she was with them. You know what Dorcas's ministry was? She was a seamstress. She was sewing garments for people to wear. In the name of Jesus, you know that? You can sew in the name of Jesus. You can give people a shirt. You can give people a jacket in the name of Jesus. That's what this woman's ministry was. She loves on the poor, literally giving them the shirt off of her back. She's sewing garments. That word for garment is the word for the garment that sticks closest to the skin. She wants to provide somebody with something that is going to keep them warm in the night when they are cold. That's how she's going to demonstrate the love of Jesus to them, with a kind, charitable act. And so they're all there, and they are weeping, showing these tunics and the other garments that she had made. You know, I think Tabitha proves to be an example for us to imitate. Her selfless service to those who are helpless in the name of Jesus is an example for us to imitate. It says in Galatians chapter 6, verse 9 through 10, the Apostle Paul wrote this. Listen to this as I read. And let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are of the household of faith. Paul says, this is what we ought to be doing. We ought to be caring for the needy. We ought not grow weary in doing good. Don't give up. If your ministry is sewing garments for the needy, don't give up. You will reap the reward in due time. Don't discount the things that you may think are small when it comes to ministry. There is no such thing as a small ministry when it is done in the name of Jesus. So Tabitha proves to be an example for us. Someone that we should imitate. Look at verse 40 and 41, an interesting turnaround here. But Peter put them all outside. So all these widows who are weeping, but Peter put them all outside and knelt down and prayed. And turning to the body, he said, Tabitha, arise. And she opened her eyes, and when she saw Peter, she sat up. You'll notice here that Peter shows at minimum two evidences of being a humble man, of being a humble servant of the Lord. So why did they summon Peter from Lydda? Because he is coming with all types of fanfare. He has just told a man in the name of Jesus to rise up and walk, a paralyzed man. You could see how something like that could go to Peter's head. But every time you see Peter healing somebody in the book of Acts, every time you see him giving credit to Jesus. Remember at the beautiful gate when he's walking with John up to the temple at the hour of prayer and he heals the man in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. And then he's explaining to everybody there in Solomon's portico and he says, don't think that it's according to any power or piety within us. It's the name of Jesus that made this man walk. Jesus, who was raised from the dead, made this man to walk. Peter is under no false pretense as to where his power comes from. Peter's not trying to get puffed up in his arrogance or puffed up because of the things that he's doing on the Lord's behalf in the name of Jesus. So here's the first sign of Peter's humility. Look at what it says. But Peter put them all outside. He says, you don't have to be a witness to what's going on here. You don't have to see what's taking place. I don't need you to watch me and then come and glorify me as though I did anything. He doesn't want anybody to be amazed by him or by what he's doing. He wants them to be amazed at the name of Jesus, at Jesus Christ, who is healing this woman, who will raise her up from the dead. So he puts them all outside. Look at the second evidence of Peter's humble approach to this healing. It says, but Peter put them all outside and knelt down and prayed. That is the sign of humility in a person's life. When a person will get on their knees before their Creator and plead. When you recognize that you didn't make the heavens and the earth, you didn't bring your life about, God made you. So I kneel before the one who made me. It's a sign of humility that Peter enacts here. He knelt down and prayed. Peter is under no false pretense as to where his power comes from, is he? He kneels before the Lord who has given him the authority to heal all manner of sickness and to, in fact, raise the dead. He kneels before God and prayed. Look at the rest of this verse. It's spectacular. And turning to the body, he said, Tabitha, arise. And she opened her eyes. And when she saw Peter, she sat up. You notice something interesting here? Peter gets done praying. He's on his knees. Doesn't say that he got up. He's on his knees. He turns to the body. I take it the Lord spoke to him and said, yes, Peter, it is my will that she be raised from the dead. Say a word to her. So Peter turns his head. He looks at the body. He said, that's not Tabitha. That's her body. He looks at the body and he says, Tabitha, arise. And what does she do? She sat up. She opened her eyes. It's incredible. You notice something here? Peter didn't lift a finger. Peter did nothing. No defibrillator, no CPR, no shock pads, no nothing. He just says a word to her in the name of Jesus. Tabitha, arise. He doesn't lift a finger. This is not Peter's power to raise Tabitha from the dead. This is Jesus's power. All Peter has to do is speak the word of obedience that God has commanded him to. Tabitha, arise. What does it say? And she opened her eyes, and when she saw Peter, she sat up. Look at verse 41. And he gave her his hand and raised her up. Then, calling the saints and widows, he presented her alive. You talk about going through a full range of emotions in less than a 24-hour period. Have you ever felt like that's happened to you? You go from a mountaintop to a valley in one day. These people go from a valley to a mountaintop in really just a span of about 30 minutes probably. They have been mourning, they have been weeping, and here comes Peter walking hand in hand with Tabitha down the stairs, and they see her and he says, she's alive. Can you imagine? They are laughing. They can't even believe this. Hugging her, crying, not tears of mourning, but tears of joy. So thankful that God has worked this miracle in her life. I find this interesting. In Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 4, the writer says, there is a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. You wouldn't think that those two things would happen in the same day, would you? You would think that the time to mourn would carry on. The time to laugh would carry on. But you wouldn't think they'd be smashed right up against each other in the same occurrence, mourning and laughter, weeping and dancing. But this is the truth. Please understand this. For the death of a person who loved Jesus, there is mourning and rejoicing at the same moment. The time for mourning and the time for rejoicing is not days apart. It is simultaneous. Because for the person who loves Jesus, the person who died in Christ, just like Tabitha here, it is a short-lived funeral. In the previous text, when you push these two texts together, you see a bit of a theme. Verse 32 through 35, you see that Jesus displays his power over the body. Jesus is Lord over the body, able to heal a paralyzed man. You also see that Jesus is Lord over the soul. He saves the souls of the citizens of Lydda and Sharon. Now you see that Jesus is Lord over the resurrection. He is Lord over death. Anytime you see a resurrection take place in the Bible, there are two things being demonstrated. Please understand this. Anytime you see a resurrection in the Bible, there are two things being demonstrated. First, what you see demonstrated is the power of God to raise the dead to life. You see that God is Lord over life and death. That's what you see displayed. What does Jesus tell Mary as he approaches the tomb of Lazarus? Lazarus has been dead for a number of days. His body, in fact, the text says his body began to stink. And as Jesus approaches his tomb, here comes Mary, Lazarus's brother. And she says, Lord, if you'd have just shown up sooner, if you'd have just shown up sooner. And Jesus turns to her. It says in John 11, 25, and Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. He says, I can show up late to Lazarus's tomb because it is never too late for Jesus to raise his body up from the dead. Why? Because he is the resurrection. He has the power of God to raise the dead to life. The second thing that you see in any resurrection in the Bible is this. Not only the power of God displayed, but you see the promise of God fulfilled and prophesied. You see the promise of God fulfilled and prophesied. In Revelation chapter 21, verse 4, it says this about the eternal kingdom of God. That in that day it says, Revelation 21, 4, he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore. For the former things have passed away. This is exactly what he has done in Tabitha's life, in all these people's life. He has turned their mourning into laughter in an instant. He has wiped away tears from their eyes. He has conquered death right there in their midst. He has displayed his power over life and death, and he has displayed that he will be faithful to raise the dead in Christ to eternal life. Jesus says in John 6, verse 40, this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life. And Jesus says, and I will raise him up on the last day. That's the hope that we have over the death that we are sure to experience, righteous and unrighteous alike. You can strive all you want in this life to have a better life. You can get a better job. You could try to find a better marriage. You could try to find a better home. You could try to find a better church. But you find all those things, and it will not take care of the greatest problem, which is the death that the righteous and the unrighteous alike will experience. The only one who can take care of that greatest problem is Jesus, who says, and I will raise him up on the last day. This example of Tabitha being raised up from the dead is a display of God's power to give life to your mortal body. This passage is intended for us to deal with our own funeral reality. So that when people attend our funeral, they say, this funeral will be short-lived because of God's promise to raise the dead in Christ to eternal life. God not only has promised you that if you will look on his Son and believe in him, he has not only promised you that he will raise you up on the last day, he has proved that he has the power to do it. He raised Tabitha from the dead. Moreover, he raised his own son, Jesus Christ, the first fruits of the resurrection. He raised him up from the dead. What a glorious promise for us in Christ. But that promise is only for those in Christ. Because Jesus raises the dead to life, we can have hope that is greater than death. This is the great hope that we have, that just as God raised Tabitha to life, just as God raised Jesus to life, he will also give life to our mortal bodies. And then in that day, mortality will be swallowed up in immortality. The grave is swallowed up and death loses its sting. It loses its grip on us because our Savior has gone before us and he has conquered both our sin on the cross and our death in his resurrection. You know what this does for us? Two things. It does first one thing for the person who is scared to death of dying. This tells you that if you will place your faith in Jesus, you do not have to fear death. If you will place your faith in Jesus, God will forgive you of your sins and he will raise your body to eternal life. But it not only speaks a word to those who believe in the or who don't believe in the Lord Jesus, it also speaks a word to those who do believe in the Lord Jesus. Because Jesus will raise your body from the dead to eternal life, you are free to live and die for the Lord. You're free to do anything that God calls you to do because you are free from the fear of death. Death will not be the victor over you if you are in Christ. So you're free to live radically for the Lord Jesus. You're free to give radically. You could give your own bread and water away and die by serving the poor. God will raise your body up from the dead. You are free to serve the Lord. You are free to live life in the fullness of joy because you're not worried about tomorrow. You're not worried about your death. You're not worried about getting hit by a car on the freeway. All that means is glory for me in heaven. I'm going to get to see Jesus, and he will give life to my mortal body. Have no fear in this life because of the resurrection. Because Jesus raises the dead to life, we can have hope that is greater than death. So you see why verse 42 is fulfilled here. It says, and it became known throughout all Joppa, and many believed in the Lord. How could you reject such power? How could you reject such a promise, such an offer made to people who don't deserve it? Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. This is the offer that Jesus gives to sinners, even the chief of sinners, as Saul of Tarsus would say. So it says, it became known throughout all Joppa, and many believed in the Lord. Because they say, if this is a reality for Tabitha, I want this to be a reality for me too. I want victory over sin and death. So how do they ascertain that? Believe in the Lord Jesus. Verse 43 says, and he stayed in Joppa for many days with one Simon, a tanner. The Lord's going to keep Peter there in Joppa for a number of days because he still has gospel work for Peter to do there in Caesarea to the north. In just a few days, he's going to take Peter up to the north to preach the gospel to the Gentiles, to tell them that they too also can lay hold of the resurrection in Christ. They too also can receive the Lord Jesus. Those who are not Jews can receive the Lord Jesus just as well. Those who are outcasts, those who were not once the people of God, they can be called the people of God. How? By calling on the name of the Lord Jesus. That promise that God will raise the mortal bodies of all those who believe in his name is good not just for Tabitha. It's good not just for the Jews. It is good for you and I also. To all who call on the name of the Lord, what does the Apostle Paul say? They shall be saved. Friends, because Jesus raises the dead to life, we can have hope that is greater than death. Would you pray with me?